some years ago, I was at a youth retreat where they had
one of the great questions that people
God the Creator
should be obvious by these gentlemen.
If you were looking down
Lord Jesus from
high minds of God the Creator.
And he will gather us around himself, and we'll be at home, and we'll never say goodbye. There'll be the rejoicing, the marriage day of the Lamb. I don't want to cross the line to impropriety, but the consummation of a marriage is a very special thing, isn't it? We are presently engaged to the Lord Jesus. We are not married to him. The word that is used for the earnest of the Spirit in Ephesians chapter 1 is the word used in modern Greek for the engagement ring. And that ring is a, so to speak, an earnest, a promise, a declaration. There's a big day coming, a day when we who have trod the lonely desert at last meet our bridegroom. And again, I don't want to be carnal in thinking, but we have to realize that what a bride-to-be enjoys before the wedding pales into insignificance on that day when man and woman are united in a special way, the consummation of the marriage. And the Lord uses this picture to remind us that there is yet a day coming when the best that we have enjoyed of Christ now will be far surpassed. It is called far better. Far better. That means that I will not be at the back of a crowd. I don't understand the geography of heaven, but I have the Lord Jesus personally with me every moment of the day. And for me to end up at the back of a crowd, seeing the Lord Jesus talking to somebody else down at the front, will not be far better. I don't know how the Lord's going to arrange it, but I know that I'm going to have him personally for myself, and you will too. We shall see him not at the back of a crowd holding up our opera glasses. We will see him face to face, face to face. Then we have the return. The Lord is going to come back, and he's going to establish his kingdom, not any old where, but in the very city from which he was taken out to be crucified. And those who saw him, who pierced him, will bemoan the fact. They will fall before him. The kings of the earth will gasp. They'll shut their mouths at him when Jesus returns. And he'll return with us. And he will be admired in his saints. He will manifest to the world that these folks gathered in this auditorium were his own brothers. He will not be ashamed of us in that day. I trust we're not ashamed of him now. He's nothing to be ashamed of. He will not be ashamed of us in that day. Your life is hid with Christ in God. This is not the day for our applause. This is not the day for our plaudits and our being accepted by the world. Your life is hid with Christ in God. But when Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall you appear with him in glory. When the Prime Minister or the President is going to appear in glory, and all the TV cameras are there, he doesn't say, hold on, just wait a minute here. Come into the picture here, that's good. This is the man who prepares my breakfast every morning. Here's the lady that cleans my bedroom. Good. Oh, yes, come in, Alice, that's good. Let's gather around her. This man shines my shoes here, come, that's it, that's good, good. Can everybody get in the picture here? They don't appear with him in glory, do they? But the lowliest servant, the humblest of God's people, in that day, he'll make sure we're all in the picture. We shall appear with him in glory. It's called the manifestation of the sons of God, the unveiling of the sons of God, when those of us who look like butchers and bakers and candlestick makers will suddenly appear as those whom we really are, the seed royal, the ruling class of heaven. It'll be quite a day, won't it? When God will be vindicated that he picked the right man for the job, that the Lord Jesus has done what he said he would do. He has finished the work which God gave him to do.